Good morning to all of my brothers and sisters in the name of Jesus Christ. To all who are with us this morning, who are pilgrimites, we greet you with the joy of the risen Savior. I want to just thank God for continuing to cover us, lead, guide, and direct us on this journey. I thank each and every one of you for continuing to support God through the ministry here at Pilgrim Baptist. I just thank God for where He has brought us from, but most of all, where He is leading us to. I ask that you will continue to pray one for the other. I ask that you will continue to pray for those who are going through a time of bereavement. So I ask now that you continue putting your children on for our Sunday school every first and third Sunday, beginning at 8:45 to that of 9:15, only a half an hour. Come on, brothers, come on, sisters. Can we invest a half an hour in the spiritual lives of our children? Truly, God has blessed us when we have dedicated them back to Him. I come now asking that you join us this morning as we come to you from the Gospel according to Luke chapter 23, verses 1 through 11. And I will be speaking to you this morning from the thought, Jesus the Redeemer. Jesus the Redeemer, think about it, who stood in our place, who paid a price for us that we could have never paid. I ask that you will continue to just lift up His name that others might know and hear He is Lord. Come join us now as we enter into worship this morning. May it be uplifting, inspiring, and informative that you may apply it to all of your lives. God bless you and enjoy the message. morning to all of my brothers and sisters. We greet you in the precious name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. We welcome you to another worship experience with us here at Pilgrim, our Baptist Church. We solicit your prayers and we ask that you will pray one for the other. Join us this morning as we come to you out of the Gospel of Luke, chapter 23, beginning at verse 1. Chapter 23, out of the Gospel of Luke, beginning at verse 1. These words are penned for our understanding and our exaltation. And the whole multitude of them arose and led him unto Pilate. And they began to accuse him, saying, "We found this fellow perverting the nation and forbidding to give tribute to Caesar, saying that he himself is Christ a king." And Pilate asked him, saying, "Art thou the king of the Jews?" And he answered him and said, "Thou sayest." Then said Pilate to the chief priests and to the people, "I find no fault in this man." And they were the more fierce, saying, "He stirreth up the people, teaching throughout all Jewry, beginning from Galilee to this place." When Pilate heard of Galilee, he asked whether the man were a Galilean. And as soon as he knew that he belonged unto Herod's jurisdiction, he sent him to Herod, who himself also was at Jerusalem at that time. And when Herod saw Jesus, he was exceeding glad, for he was desirous to see him of a long season, because he had heard many things of him, and he hoped to have seen some miracle done by him. Then he questioned with him in many words, but he answered him nothing. And the chief priests and scribes stood and vehemently accused him. And Herod with his men of war set him at naught and mocked him and arrayed him in a gorgeous robe and sent him, again to Pilate. I want to stop at this 11th verse, verses 1 through 11. I would like to speak to us this morning concerning Jesus the Redeemer. I want to talk about Jesus the Redeemer. One of the things, brothers and sisters, we need to consider, and that is, no man is an island and no man stands alone. As we make our way in this wilderness journey, we must ask ourselves, who is it that has given us this liberty? Who is it that has paid the price for our freedom? The word redeemer means one who buys back or purchases back that which had been sold or that which had been enslaved. Brothers and sisters, upon the earthly entry and advent of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, he came into a world that he examined and found that many of his creation called man was sitting on, amen, the shelves in a pawn shop with, amen, a price tag on them. The Bible teaches us that all of us have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And in the coming of our Lord and Savior Jesus the Christ, he came in the form of a babe, grew into that of a man. And now, amen, he's at a point of paying the cost, paying the price that man might be delivered from the dominion of Satan. This world is not our home. This world is a wicked place. But Jesus came anyhow, knowing, amen, even how he would leave, knowing how he would suffer, knowing what price he had to pay in order to redeem man back unto himself and his Father. Oh, brothers and sisters, what would you think if you, amen, was in prison and you did not have anything to go your bail? How would you feel, amen, if no one stepped up, amen, in order to pay your bail that you might be released out of jail? Here we are, having been in prison, having been in a spiritual jailhouse, having been, amen, under the warden called Satan. And now we have Jesus, the Christ, who is also the Redeemer, who has come in order that he might pay a price that man could not pay. Out of all of Jesus' exploits, Jesus was showing humanity that God was among them. He truly identified. He truly, amen, gave witness of his name, Emmanuel, meaning that God was and is with us. Oh, brothers and sisters, aren't you glad that the Lord did not leave us alone? Aren't you glad that God, amen, had pity upon his creation called man? Man, amen, has been up one minute and down the next minute, good one minute and sinful the next minute, but God's patience did not wear out. Jesus came and he taught. Jesus came and he performed miracles. Jesus came and he tried to show men and women the way back to God. So brothers and sisters, here we are now as Jesus, amen, had prepared himself and his disciples for his departure. Oh, at one point he had asked his disciples, "Who do men say that I the Son of Man am?" And Simon beheld his words and said, "Sir, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God." Oh, brothers and sisters, we come just to bear record this morning that if it had not been for God on our side, where would we be? How many of us have been redeemed? How many of us have been saved? How many of us have been restored? How many of us has been spiritually resurrected? If I can use my spiritual mind, I can see Jesus walking through the pawn shop and looking on the shelf and seeing our names with a price on it. A price that none of us could pay. A price, amen, that was too high, with man being poor of spirit. Jesus here, amen, stands now before that of Pilate. Our text lets us know that they had accused him, amen, of being a blasphemer. And by the time he gets to Pilate, amen, he is now a traitor to Rome. So brothers and sisters, as we look at our text, I would like for us to take a self-examination. Because it says now that the whole multitude of them arose and led him unto Pilate, which means these are they that came out of the great Sanhedrin. The Sanhedrin Council was, amen, the high religious council for the Jews. They judged, amen, those things that were supposed to be right. But now they could not see, amen, the justified one in their midst. They arose and led him to Pilate. And they began, amen, in verse number 2, to accuse him, saying that Jesus was perverting the nation. Jesus now was forbidding to give tribute to Caesar. Now, not only did they have false accusation, but they outright lied against Jesus. Because someone had asked Jesus at one point as they gave a question to him, trying to trick him. It says, is it lawful, amen, to give tribute to Caesar or not? Jesus answered and says, render unto Caesar that which is Caesar's, and unto God that which is God. Jesus taught us not only to follow the spiritual law, but we have a civil mandate that we have to follow as well. They straight out lied when he said he forbade them to give to Caesar, saying that he himself is Christ, a king. Pilate, listening to all of this, asked him, saying, art thou king of the Jews? And Jesus turns and says, you say it. Jesus did not say anything, but unto Pilate, he said, now you say that I am. Brothers and sisters, what would you say? How would you define your relationship with Jesus? Do you know that he is the Messiah? Do you know that he is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords? But now, this is the time that Jesus was born for. This is the time that has now come for Jesus to pay the ultimate price for man's redemption. Oh, anybody that's been redeemed, you have been bought out of, amen, a spiritual slavery. You've been paid, amen, the money has been paid for you to come out of the dominion under Satan. You realize who God is. You realize who Jesus is. And Pilate said unto him, unto the chief priests and the people, he says, I find no fault in this man. Pilate said, out of all that you say, I have not found anything that is worthy of death. So I'm going to, amen, scourge him, and then I'm going to release him. When he made this statement, amen, their voices rose, amen, more louder, and he stirred up, amen, the people, teaching throughout all Jewry, beginning at Galilee to this place. He wanted him to know that Jesus had been preaching all over the land, teaching them the ways of his Father, teaching them how to love one another, teaching them how to forgive one another. Oh, brothers and sisters, I come to bear record that Pilate declares Christ innocent. Listen to what I say. Even Pilate, being the governor at that time, declared Jesus innocent. But yet it was the chief priest, amen, that rose up, amen, and cried more loudly, saying that he stirs up the people. Well, brothers and sisters, I'm so glad that the Holy Ghost will stir you up. I'm so glad that the Holy Ghost will make you get out of self. I'm so glad that the Spirit of God, amen, will make you recognize who God is and who the Son of God is, that you might give him glory, honor, and praise. I'm so thankful for our Redeemer. I'm so thankful that he hung in there, and it was love that kept his mouth closed. It was love that would not let him say a murmuring word. And he found out, Pilate had found out that Herod was in town. And knowing that he was a Galilean, he says, I'm going to get this man off my hands. I'm going to send him to Herod. Herod was exceedingly glad. Herod was anxious to see the one called Jesus because he had heard so much about him. Oh, brothers and sisters, how glad are you? How happy would you be if you had an intimate relationship with Jesus? No one has ever met Jesus and stayed the same. Oh, Herod and Antipas, a man was the one sitting in the ruler's seat of Galilee. And now, a man, he was hoping to see a miracle. Now, brothers and sisters, yes, he was glad that he was getting a chance to meet Jesus. But his motives was wrong. Oh, how about you and I? When we come and when we have, amen, an opportunity to meet Jesus, is our motives right? He wanted to see a miracle. He wanted to have something to brag about. He treated Jesus like a magician. He treated Jesus like a man, a witch doctor. He was wanting him to just conjure up and do a miracle. Well, brothers and sisters, let me tell you, Jesus is working miracles for you and I every day. Jesus, amen, is still, amen, bringing about the redemptive plan to all of those who are lost. I don't know who I'm speaking to, but those who are lost, amen, have no joy. Those who are lost, amen, have no peace. Those who are lost have no song, amen, and praise to God in their mouths. Misery loves company. And there are some miserable people all because they don't realize that joy comes from the Lord. Peace comes from the Lord. Love comes from the Lord. All of those things that would make our lives content. All of those things that would, amen, lead you and I to helping our fellow man. All of those, amen, words that he spoke that brought about a change in our moral status in the world. Morality, decency, human kindness has flown out the window. There are those who are trying to superficially and artificially gather joy. But the joy that they have don't last long. I'm so glad the songwriter says, come on, Shirley Caesar, this joy that I have, the world didn't give it to me and the world can't take it away. So brothers and sisters, we look at the exploits that is going on in chapter 23 of that of Luke. Luke being the mighty physician. He realized, amen, that then Pilate said that he found no fault, sent him over to Herod. Herod, amen, examined him, and Herod himself had no fault. Jesus didn't answer him anything. But Herod, with his men of war, set him at naught and mocked him and arrayed him in a gorgeous robe. This is in verse 11. And sent him again to Pilate. Now, they mocked him as a king. They mocked him as one in authority. Not realizing that they, amen, was dealing with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Oh, brothers and sisters, Pilate, amen, was in a fix. Herod sent him right back to Pilate. Amen. And here's the strange thing. Herod and Pilate was at enmity with each other. In other words, they hated one another. They had no peace with each other. But after they met Jesus, they became friends. Oh, isn't it something? For enemies to make peace and become friends after meeting the Prince of Peace. Oh, brothers and sisters, Jesus will make a change in the lives of men and women if they only would come on the Lord's side. We move, amen, on, and we find that no, nor Herod and Pilate found anything in Jesus that was worthy of death. But the priests, scribes, and the people of Israel cried out the more, knowing that this here was their highest Sabbath time. Pilate knew that their agreement was that he needed to release a prisoner from prison, one that they desired. And in verse 18 it says, and they cried out all at once, saying, away with this man. Away with this man, and release unto us Barabbas. Now Barabbas was one of sedition. Barabbas was one who had murdered. Barabbas was one who had done great harm because he did not care for the Romans. Jesus now would take his place. Oh, brothers and sisters, I want you to look at this. It called him a man of sedition, which means his sins were great. There are many things that, amen, Barabbas had done that he was truly worthy of death. Jesus took the worst one. Jesus took the one that should have been, amen, hanging on that cross. Jesus took his place. So, brothers and sisters, we find that as the story moves forward, that they, amen, released Jesus, amen, unto the people. And it says in verse 23, and they were instant with loud voices, requiring he might be crucified. And the voices of them and of the chief priests prevail. Now I want you to look at this. This was the religious sector that was coming up against Jesus because Jesus was making a difference in the lives of people. Those who had come on the Lord's side were now humble, were now loving, and they were, amen, surrounding themselves, not following that of Rome, but following the teachings of Jesus. And as they led him away, the Bible says that they had scourged him in Matthew. They had scourged him in Mark. They had whipped him with 40 stripes less one. And now they were leading him to Calvary. They were leading him through the city of Jerusalem. They wanted to shame him. They wanted to degrade him. And all along, they were mocking him. Brothers and sisters, how do we take, amen, people lying on us? How do we feel when people are making fun of us? How do we feel when people hurt your feelings? How do you feel even when you've been backstabbed? How do you feel, amen, when those that you love don't love you? How do you feel when you've done, amen, what you needed to do for others and they turn on you? Jesus didn't do anything but good. Jesus humbled himself to the work of his Father. not of himself, but to the work of his Father. And now, a man making his way to Calvary. It says, and as they were on their way, they took hold of one called Simon, a Cyrenian. Oh, brothers and sisters, and laid the cross that Jesus bore on him. I'm so glad, amen, that there was a Cyrenian. I'm so glad that he was, amen, one that could carry the cross. Jesus had been beaten to an inch of his life, but I want us to realize no man would take his life because he had to give it. And even during this time, with all of his bruises, with all of his stripes, with all of the blood running down, Jesus struggled, but he made it, amen, to Calvary. And it says that when he got there in verse 32, he says, and there were also two other men, amen, that was led with him to be put on the cross. They would be on one side and the other would be on the other side. And brothers and sisters, Jesus is in the middle. Let me point this out. Now, the way that they crucified my Lord, it says that they hung him and derided him as they hung him up between two evil men. Two men who was worthy of death. Amen. And as they put nails in his hands, he said not a murmuring word. All because the contract Jesus had signed with his Father, he had to willingly give of himself on behalf of man. The first Adam fell, and now the second Adam was prevailing. Satan really didn't want Jesus to make it to the cross. That's why, amen, Pilate was so eager to turn him loose. He knew that they were jealous. He knew that the people were angry. He knew that they, amen, just conjured up things to get Jesus out of the way. It was all about money, pride, prestige, and their ability to control. But Jesus, knowing their hearts, never said a murmuring word. But oh, as we look at the scene of Calvary, it was called Golgotha's Hill. But when they carried Jesus and the other malefactors up that way, it was now called Calvary. Brothers and sisters, I heard Jesus say in the 34th verse, he says, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And they parted his raiment and cast lots for his vestiture. Brothers and sisters, as they were there, Jesus, amen, made spiritual intercession because he was dealing with spiritual ignorance. All the priests, amen, amen, and the chief priests should have known who he was, but because they were about sin, Jesus, amen, carried on, amen, to meet his divine challenge. Oh, Jesus, being the Redeemer, had to go through some suffering times in order to pay the price for you and me. Verse 35 lets us know, and the people stood beholding, And the rulers also with them derided him, saying, he saved others. Let him now save himself, if he be the Christ of Almighty God. Let him call on God, and God will bring him down from the cross. And Jesus heard them, and still he never said a murmuring word. He had to fulfill the scriptures. Coming out of Isaiah 53:12, he was numbered among the transgressors and bare the sins of many and made intercession for the transgressors. Can't you see him as he was on that cross? They stretched him wide. And they lifted him high. They wanted to, in order to silence the people, they wanted to make him a public example. Aren't you glad that Jesus is the right public example? He hung on that cross because love kept him up there. I don't know about you, but it was Jesus who paid the spiritual price for you and for me. And as he hung on that cross, it says in 36 that there were soldiers also mocking him, coming to him and offering him vinegar. Jesus never took the vinegar. He turned away because he had to feel the full suffering of all mankind. I come to bear record that they hung him on that cross. And we need to know that he was truly the Son of Almighty God. He was fully man and he was fully divine. So I come to bear record as we look at the scene. Can you imagine him hanging there? Can you imagine him looking down upon the people? Can you imagine him when he said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do? Can you imagine him looking to the thief on the left and the thief on the right? And can you imagine that when they hung him on the cross, Pilate had already put out the superscription that he was the King of Kings. He was the King of the Jews. He put it in Greek, Latin, and Hebrew so that everyone would read, this is the King of the Jews. No matter what they say, I realized that there was something unique about this man. So I'm going to call him who I believe him to be. Ain't the Lord all right? Is Jesus your King? Is Jesus your Redeemer? Is Jesus your mighty friend? But he stayed there on that cross. He took all of the slander. He took all of the lies. He took all of the railings. He took all of the derailing. He took all of the noise and the talk that man would have to give. They say, look at him now, hanging on the cross. Look at him now, being the Son of God. look at him now, saying he was somebody, but I come to bear record, when you look to the hills, from where cometh your help will come from the Lord. How many times have we turned on the news and lies have been going here and that way? How many times have you turned on the news and saw where bodies was laying all over? How many times have you turned on the news and heard that this one was killed and this one was abducted? How many times have you had to hear all of the sin that was going on in the world? But I'm so glad that I serve a Savior. I'm so glad he's sweet, I know. And here on the cross, here was this other thief on the left saying unto him, amen, if thou be the Christ, save thyself and us. Oh, but there was the other one on the other side. Said, man, you ought to be ashamed. Do you not have fear of God? We're here because we are justly, amen, reaping what we sowed. We are here because we have done wrong. We are here because we have a man turned against Caesar. We are here because we have broken the law. But this man has done nothing worthy of death. So we come to let you know that this thief on the right says in his own words, and he said unto Jesus, Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Ain't the Lord all right? I'm so glad that Jesus told us, coming out of John chapter 14, he says, I'm going away to prepare a place, and if I go, I'm coming again to receive you unto myself. I come to bear record that those who call on the name of the Lord, he says, shall be saved. I'm so glad that Jesus paid it all. And on that day, he put brakes on death and said, verily to the man, this day you will be with me in paradise. I come to bear record. No man took his life, but Jesus was giving his life, and it was about the sixth hour. And the Bible says, and there was darkness all over the land. The mountains started to rumble. And the sun refused to shine. Don't you know the Redeemer? My Lord is on the cross. The Redeemer is making a way for you and me. God could not bear to see his son wrapped in sin, hanging on the cross. So darkness fell, and I heard it started to lightning, it started to thunder, rain started to fall, all because the Redeemer was paying the price. I don't know about you, but I gotta praise his name. I don't know about you, but I gotta glorify him. I don't know about you, I'm glad I'm saved. I don't know about you, he brought me a long way. The Redeemer has come. The Redeemer paid our bail. The Redeemer got us out of the pawn shop. The Redeemer took us off the ship. The Redeemer set us free. Ain't the Lord all right? Well, it goes on that he hung his head and then he died. They say it's over now. We've gotten him out of the way. But don't don't you remember? He says, I will die and I will be buried, but in 3 days I'm coming back again. They laid him in a borrowed grave, and they laid him there all night Friday. They laid him there all day Saturday. They laid him there all night Saturday night. But early on Sunday morning, something started to happen. The stone was rolled away. My Savior got up from the grave. Ain't he all right? Can you praise him? Can you glorify him? Can you magnify him? He's all right. He paid the ultimate price for you and me, the Redeemer. One who bought us back from spiritual deadness. One who brought us back from Satan's clutches. We couldn't have done it ourselves, but he did. That cross, the cross of rebellion was there. The cross of salvation, the cross of redemption. Oh, remember me, the man said. He was in the same shape Jesus was in, but spiritually saw that Jesus had a kingdom. Oh, brothers and sisters, I don't care what the world may say. There's no one like God. I'm going to give the call to discipleship at this moment. And if there's someone who is looking for a change in life, there's someone who would like to be saved, would you repeat after me this morning? Father, I come to you now. Forgive me of my sins and my transgressions. I ask you into my life. I believe Jesus is your Son. I believe he is my Redeemer. I believe he was buried. I believe that he rose again, having all power in his hand. So I ask you now, meet me where I am, mold me and shape me, is my prayer. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. If you repeated these words, the Bible says you are now a child of the King if you're sincerely asking him. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father in heaven, we truly thank you for this hour. We thank you for this time. We thank you for your word. Most of all, we thank you for your Son who came, bled, and died that all of us might have right and might have a choice of eternal life. I ask you now to cover everyone that has listened in. Cover those who will hear this sermon. Cover those who are seeking for a new way. I ask, oh God, that you will be patient. I ask, oh God, that you will be lovingly kind. Amen. That you will be long-suffering, that they might have an opportunity to turn back unto you. I ask your blessings upon the bereaved, the sick, the afflicted, the shut-in. I ask your blessings upon the careless and the unconcerned, those behind prison walls. Father, protect us now and move upon Ukraine and Russia during this time. Realize that man is in conflict when man is not in line with you. Therefore, we place this situation in your hands. This is a servant's prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. And brothers and sisters, remember, Pastor Rector truly loves you, and there is nothing you can do about it. Have a blessed and wonderful day.
The song we sing in our church. How many have at least one? one thing to be thankful for. And so put your hands together. He did it all.